to say. First, don't presume that a doctor will treat you, and if one does, don't expect the treatment will be up to the standards you had some years ago. In fact, the conservative revolution says we are in a new age, the information age, and such things as the Hippocratic Oath, which doctors have taken for 2,000 years, is outmoded. On the right here, you see the three ages often referred to by Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich. The first wave from hunting and gathering to agriculture, the second wave from agriculture to industry, and the third wave, which he is pushing beyond industry. Well, this quote then you see that follows on the right is from a speech the Speaker of Gingrich gave to the American Hospital Association only a few weeks ago, January 30th, here in Washington. And that's when he said that we have to shift out of things like the Hippocratic Oath. His exact words are there in front of you. We are moving into a genuine information age, in Alvin and Heidi Toffler's phrase, a third wave of change. As you think about the future of hospitals, the future of healthcare, the future of medicine, the Hippocratic Oath comes from a period of the rise of an agriculture situation. Then how big is the shift from agriculture to industry and the shift beyond industry and beyond medicine? What this means in real terms, you see on your left in the view of a shutdown hospital. The third wave conservative revolution has no place for traditional medicine such as community hospitals and beds and labs and diagnostic services and clinics. No. They say that the guild or monopoly power of nurses and doctors and traditions must be broken. The individual patient must be re-empowered to be responsible for his or own health, they say. If you get sick, it's your fault. On the right, you see the exact words of Speaker Gingrich to the Hospital Association. He said, there's no reason in the age of the internet that if you have a disease and you can access the information personally, that you can't learn about it personally. We need to re-empower citizens and then make them more responsible. That requires breaking down the guild attitude, which has kept medical knowledge as though it were an exclusive class. This will cause a revolution and lower the cost of health care. In fact, hospitals are shutting down at record rates. In the 1980s, I'll refer you to the picture on the left again. In the 1980s, in the whole 10-year period, there were probably 780 hospitals shut down. I mean, more than 50 a year. That's one for every state. It didn't work like that. Most of them were concentrated in the rural counties and here in Washington, New York, Chicago, San Diego, the cities. And there were only 6,000 or 7,000 hospitals to begin with. So that instead of a situation where you have the number of beds per 1,000 people that modern medicine and public health require, you don't have it. You don't have any beds, perhaps. Texas, 56 out of 254 counties have no hospitals at all. You should have maybe 5 general use beds per 1,000 people and another 5 if you've got specialty AIDS cases, tuberculosis cases, other problems. But hundreds of counties have no beds at all. And there's the same shortage in diagnostic medicine, physicians, nurses, and public health services. Here you see a color map on the left of the United States. You can just get a general impression from this because it shows the 3,000 counties in the country where there are doctor shortages. The yellow counties have a serious shortage of physicians for their people. Look how much is yellow in the west, the northern rural areas in the south. The red counties have shortages in local areas within their counties. The green counties aren't great. They're just not reporting crises when this map was prepared a year ago by some rural state senators. It's much worse now. So what does the conservative revolution tell you to do about this? Forget about it. If you're sick in the country, and you can't get to a hospital because there's none there, or if you're sick in the city, no one will treat you, there's no hospital, forget it. Go for what Speaker Gingrich calls distance medicine. get a computer, grab your laptop. Here's what he told the Hospital Association on the right. Change things so that wherever you are in this country, you get distance medicine in the most rural areas, on Indian reservations, and in the poorest neighborhoods. And get doctors in the hospitals in the habit of automatically accessing the world database. All right, those are his exact words. So much for the generalities. Now look at the specifics that are being proposed and the cuts. In fact, on the right, you see the number one healthcare proposal of the conservative revolution, balance the budget. He said, we need a new vision of health in America, which, by the way, precedes healthcare. It has to start with a vision of healthcare within a balanced federal budget, but with every citizen having far more responsibility than they have today. That means you're on your own, because the cuts are going to dismantle the existing healthcare system such as it is. There are direct and indirect cuts. I'll go through them very briefly. The direct cuts you have already heard are in Medicare, health care for the elderly, and Medicaid, health care for those unable to pay. This means a direct shutdown of hospitals. The image you have seen on your left of a hospital shutdown is Bronx Hospital in New York, shut down before or around 1980 by Mayor Koch at the time. One of our great hospitals. Now it's just pushing up weeds, absolutely empty. It's a movie set for Hollywood for a horror show. But we now face a new wave, the final wave of hospital shutdown. City and rural hospitals rely on 25 to 75% of their payments for patients, their income, on Medicare and Medicaid. You cut that, and you cut out at least half of the remaining hospitals across our nation. Harlem Hospital, Columbia Presbyterian in New York City, Montefiore in New York City, City Hospital in Washington, and everyone in this room can name the hospital that will get the axe, as well as thinking of some already gone. Whereas today we have maybe 5,800 hospitals, this would mean automatically going down to 2,500. In addition, here are some other direct cuts. The conservative revolution says, cut federal money to teaching hospitals about $6 billion a year. That's where there's work on cancer, such as it is, some work on AIDS and other research. Cut federal money to the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta, Georgia, such as it is, but the new wave says don't track diseases. Cut federal money to public health. Don't guarantee safe water. Cut out those expenses. Cut federal money to do research in specialty areas such as treating AIDS and other killer diseases. That gives you a sample. There are, in addition, indirect cuts besides this. For example, the hospitals that are still operating are doing things, such as you can see on the left, such as replacing nurses with nurses' aides, that is, people who only need a few weeks' training and they do the best they can, but they get less than half the price per hour of a nurse. They're cutting other things. 25 out of 67 hospitals in Alabama have cut out all facilities for delivering babies. There are many other cuts. This gives you an example. These cuts then will have the obvious result, guarantee epidemics. There will be new diseases and faster spread of old ones. This map on the United States on the left just shows two things, AIDS and respiratory tuberculosis. It's just a sketch. The TB is shown by the circles, and that gives you the idea of the rate of increase in TB in urban areas. The bigger the circle, the more the cases per 100,000 people. You see New York, Florida, Miami, you see California, the West Coast, you see rural areas, Georgia, Alabama, and the other cities across the nation. The red color just shows a few of the states with currently a heavy caseload of AIDS cases and HIV infection. Picture in your mind, when you look at this map, overlays of additional diseases, cholera in Texas, the new hantavirus in the western states. and many more, mutations of known bacteria and fungi. You need infrastructure, you would think. But no, the conservative revolution says, in the face of this, on the right, you need things like vouchers. We'll give you a piece of paper, try and cash it in somewhere. You need choices. You need medical savings accounts. We will not go into these in detail, but I'll give you a quick picture of what they mean by something like medical savings accounts, because Senator Phil Graham proposed this in a health care bill last fall. And we have reproduced for you an exact picture from the American Council for Health Care Reform, which is a conservative revolution health care group that's backed by the major private insurance companies. Okay, on the right, you see what you're supposed to do under an MSA, medical savings account. MediSave, says Senator Graham. First, be 23 years old. And where it's in green, make sure you're in a situation, either self-employed or working for someone who guarantees you have an annual contribution of $4,500 every year, beginning now. I know there's some young people here. $1,500 of that on the left every year will go to your major comprehensive insurance policy in case you have a really bad situation. And on the right, you will put this money will be put in a savings account for you, and you can spend it on things, little things you need that year, poison ivy, you know, little things. But you will always have some left so that after 10 years, down in the bottom, your MediSave balance will be $27,510. Let's look at the next. This is from Phil Graham. You keep going. You still have $4,500 a year. You actually reduce, on the left, your major medical insurance payment of to $1,200 a year. And on the right, you continue. Don't have anything more serious than poison ivy. And down at the bottom, after 20 years in your MediSave account, you will have $77,500. And bingo, at age 65, as we now see, you will have $276,000. And the small print there from Senator Graham's office says this balance can be used for long-term care during older age, eliminating the need for Medicare. And the remainder of the account can become part of your estate.
After Kevorkian gets to you.
So maybe, except if you've made a deal with Kevorkian and it goes to him. So what, in fact, what all this talk, what all this new age third wave talk means is an increase in the death rate. First, for the uninsured or poorly insured, wherever you may live, whatever subgroup of the population you may be in our nation. 40 million people are uninsured, 65 million may have Blue Cross or Blue Shield, now you see it, now you don't. 50 million people are paying into one of the new health groups called health maintenance organizations, HMOs. They've been around for 10, 15 years, that have been set up by the private insurance companies and others, cohorts in the privateer financial groupings. So wherever you may be, depending on what you're exposed to, there will be new diseases and new incidences and increase of diseases. On the left, you see blood in test tubes marked for AIDS protocols treatment. It's infected blood, and there's ways to handle these things if you have the infrastructure. But the proposal by the conservative revolution is to tear it down. Therefore, the rate of death will go up. Death from simple things like diarrhea, death from salmonella infections, from contaminated blood, from contaminated water, from contaminated food. You might die at home, you might die on the street, or you might die in the hospital where the nurse was replaced by an aide who meant well, but you turned blue and you died. And those kinds of incidents now are on the increase. Okay, what does this conservative revolution say to that, finally? Well, Speaker Gingrich said that the American market, that is here in the United States, is not the primary interest of the conservative revolution. He wants a healthcare system for a world market. He says that then it can be the biggest foreign exchange order the U.S. ever had. How would this be? Let's look at the Gingrich scheme specifically in this diagram cartoon. At the very top, on the right, you see the Conservative Revolution Health Projects. And you see at the top, those little airplanes are flying into an echelon in the United States of 50 to 100 centers of excellence, he calls them, where you'd have 20 cancer clinics like the Mayo Clinic, 15 heart clinics. You'd have some liver clinics and some specialty clinics like the rock groups have go to in Switzerland to get their blood changed. Anyway, the rich elite will fly in from around the world and pay big bucks for treatment at the top. What about the ordinary person? Look lower down, in the middle. You're supposed to have that distance medicine where you dial internet and find out how to treat pleurisy. That's true. Look at the bottom. This is choices, how you're supposed to balance the budget. Now, there's a lot of things listed there. We're not going over them. They're just New Age gobbledygook. In other words, vouchers. Where are you going to turn it in? Block grants. What are you going to do with it? Forget it. Some of you will be among those who are expected to die off. You see Speaker Gingrich's actual words on the left. He told the hospital association managers, he says, let's do new things, like maybe you measure the total number of medical specialists against world demand, not against American demand. And as the planet gets wealthier, you know, they will fill up a 747 every weekend to fly from Tokyo to Minneapolis to shop at the Mall of the Americas. And people who go that far for sneakers will go an immense distance to get the best liver treatment. Finally, while you're going to an early grave, look what the conservative revolution is doing, making bags of cash off this medical collapse and funneling money directly to Newt Gingrich, Phil Graham, and the others. On the left, you see a clipping to this effect. But first, look back at the right. We didn't finish with the conservative revolution scheme. On the right-hand screen, you see a column of company names listed along the left of those companies that have sprung up in the last 15 years called health maintenance organizations. There are names like Kaiser Permanente, United Healthcare. I won't read them all. There's Humana. Down at the bottom is Golden Rule Insurance. These companies have been set up and run by the major world insurance and financier networks, Prudential, Metropolitan Life, Aetna, and others. And the way these companies work is you, who can't afford anything better and don't want to go with nothing and still have a little money, you pay into their health care plan every year, and they offer you some limited care. But they really don't pay out much. They're called roach motel companies. The money goes in, and it doesn't come out. They entice you to sign up because you can't afford anything else. Then they bully the medics into not treating you. They bully the hospitals into eliminating nurses, eliminating facilities, and giving discount service. And that's how they work. On the left now, look at that Wall Street Journal report on these companies. This is a clipping from December. They're called HMOs. And it says, HMOs pile up billions in cash, trying to decide what to do with it. The membership is rising. That will be temporary. And costs fall. They make it fall, while capital needs of industry are modest. In other words, this money isn't going into our healthcare infrastructure of this nation, not clinics, not hospitals, not medics. In 1980, these kinds of companies had only a few million enrollees. This year, there will be 50 million Americans paying into this swindle. And now you see the last image. That is a chart of some of the names of the companies, and in green, some of the amounts of money they have on hand right now. Kaiser Permanente has about $1.35 billion. That's cash on hand in short-term investments, liquid cash. So they have billions, literally. The point to be made is altogether, these companies, there's about 20 top ones. The top 10 account for 22 million people paying into them. These companies are giving millions of dollars to Phil Gramm, Newt Gingrich, and others. For example, in the last 15 years, from 1979 to 1994, our preliminary research shows that Phil Gramm received overall in his operations $1.1 billion from the Political Action Committee of these companies. Senator Packwood, $1 billion. Senator Duerenberger, $1 billion. These companies are the largest contributors to Speaker of the House Gingrich. This then gives you a quick picture of how the conservative revolution and who they are standing over your intended grave.
I'm calling my discussion, Let Them Eat Cake. The United States Agriculture Department-sponsored nutrition and farm programs will have to be cut by as much as $35 billion to pay for the tax cuts called for by the Contract with America and to balance the budget by the year 2002, say the budget pork cutters from the conservative revolution. The conservative revolution wants to take your food away. The majority of a nation's stable supply of food should be produced by the family farm system of agriculture. This is the form of agriculture under attack by the budget cutters at the Heritage Foundation and in the conservative revolutionary leadership of the Republican Party. House Majority Leader and Mount Pelerin Society spokesman Dick Armey calls America's farm price supports Moscow on the Mississippi, or the equivalent of the Soviet system of agriculture. The Heritage Foundation says, dismantle the agriculture welfare state, the entire current system of subsidies. These images of Soviet-style agriculture and welfare subsidies better describe the international banks, grain traders, and food monopolies, who want to replace the entrepreneurial type of American system agriculture with a peasant practicing extractive agriculture. These are the people on welfare. They purchase from the farmer at a fraction of his real cost of production, which is called a parity price. This means the revenue from the sale of a farmer's produce must cover farm expenses, plus a profit to reinvest to maintain the productivity of the farm and to support the farm household. Market prices today average 40% of a real parity price, and with price supports, which is what's under attack, a measly 50% of parity price. The graph shows how prices have dropped precipitously as a percent of parity. The pork cutters aim at the whole commodity price support system for wheat, rice, feed grains, and cotton. The system grew up in the absence of a government commitment to enforcing a real parity price in the marketplace against the monopoly power of the international grain traders. If successful, they will eliminate the full-time family farm producers, who should be the backbone of our nation's stable food supply. Statistics from the Agriculture Department show that there are no profits being generated in the U.S. family farm sector, even with farm price supports. Since 1987, when the so-called farm crisis period ended and the, quote, recovery began, the loss of family farms continued at the same rate of 32,500 per year through 1992. Between 1992 through the year 2002, based on this trend alone, the department estimates there will be 385,000 less farms out of a current total of 1.9 million. This figure, which is itself deceptive because 1.3 million of these farms are considered not commercially viable, that is, they have commercial sales valued at less than $50,000 per year. When you eliminate the income from price supports, you will shut down the core of the family farm sector. A snowballing effect will ensue as property values collapse, credit is withdrawn, and the towns that provide off-farm employment go under. The trend out of family farming will be snowballing. And I might add that the number of farms that they officially record today of 1.9 million is the same number that the United States had in 1850. The majority of commodity support payments to farmers goes to grain farmers in 13 Midwest states. They work full-time on the farm, have off-farm income from other members of the household or Social Security, and commercial sales of between $40,000 and $250,000. These full-time family farmers, about 304,000 of them, could be said to form the backbone of the family farm of agriculture. When expenses are deducted from their income or from their sales from farming, they net an average of $16,000 per household income from farming. Included in the net income of farmers in this group is approximately $11,200, or 70% of his net income from farm program payments. When this is eliminated, so are these farms. Could you put the next graphic on? This. Because these households now have a net cash income from farming of $4,800, not enough to support one person, let alone a household. You could point to the blue in the third graph. The Agriculture Department, however, reports their household income is $31,000. How is this possible? They actually count $15,000 from off-farm income sources, Social Security, jobs that members of the household might have off the farm. These family farms stand in contrast to farms which exist under a variety of ownership, primarily to draw high rates of return for speculative investors. Included in this category are factory livestock farms. We should have a slide of one of those. Slide. See those little specks there? They're cattle. And this is one of, it's a giant livestock feeding operation of possibly 100,000 cattle. This is what you call an industrial feedlot. This type of agriculture spreads disease and causes the destruction of the soil. Net farm income is calculated by deducting production expenses, interest on debt, and real estate taxes from gross farm marketing revenue. Expenses such as fertilizer costs and interest on debt alone have risen 50% over the past year. Production expenses, as reported in the annual costs and returns survey of the Agriculture Department, do not reflect what a farmer would actually spend if he received a full cost of production return on his sales. Of the farms which the Agriculture Department deems commercially viable, which have a market value of sales of $50,000 or above, 25% of them lost money farming in 1992. Now, a form of price support is maintained for livestock producers, milk producers, and producers of fruits and vegetables by government intervention into the marketplace to buy up surplus for a variety of feeding programs, which the conservative revolution has also placed on the chopping block. With their cuts in farm price supports, what do they say about the food they don't care about producing? The Heritage Foundation's Robert Rector says that hunger in the United States is a myth cooked up by the liberals. According to Rector, there is no need for government food programs. Charity can fill whatever need exists. In response to a cut in funds of 50% in the temporary emergency food assistance program by the Clinton administration last fall, Rector said, "The program is no longer necessary. We spend too much on welfare and breed dependency and family disintegration." The reality, he claims, is that poor children often eat at higher levels of nutrition than their wealthy counterparts. On the contrary, food assistance programs run by the Agriculture Department were developed out of studies done in the 1960s identifying specific diet deficiencies leading to specific disorders in the poor population. Over 40 million Americans participate in one form or another food assistance program, including the school lunch programs and the food stamp program, over half of which are children. The supplemental nutrition program for the elderly and women and infant children. The Food Research and Action Center reports that 40% of America's poor children suffer hunger, and that 5 million under the age of 12 go hungry at some point during each month. Under the proposals of the Contract for America's Personal Responsibility Act, the 10 chief government-funded food programs, including school meals, food stamps, women and infant children, supplemental nutrition for the elderly and children, will be eliminated. Instead, funds will be transferred to the states in block grants in a lump sum. The total will be cut by $5 billion from this year's funding level, or 13%, and capped. The states could administer the funds in any way they choose without any federal standards. The budget slashers expect to save $18 billion in this way. Because of the cap on program funds, it will be impossible for states to admit new people to their programs, no matter what happens to the economy. Additionally, the bill will repeal the USDA's authority to donate commodities for feeding programs. Not only that, but the elimination of the price support programs for farm producers will eliminate the donatable surplus from stocks, which have supplied the school lunch program and all kinds of emergency and supplemental food programs. Will private charity be able to fill this gap, as the Heritage Foundation says? Nationally, 1 in 4 people are served by the food programs funded by the Department of Agriculture. Private agencies, which provide food assistance, report overwhelming increases in demand. Many of them are provided food and funds from the very programs which will be cut. Cities like New York are slashing food assistance programs under budgetary pressures. Meals on Wheels in Detroit, a food program for the elderly, which relies on both federal and private food donations, said that they do not have enough food to meet current need because Michigan's poverty rate has risen so high. A delivery van driver for this program said that most of the people he sees will die without daily food relief. The result of unmet food needs for the elderly is a measurable increase in the death rate from viruses, influenza, and other diseases because they are becoming needlessly weakened by malnutrition. The report issued in December by the U.S. Conference on Mayors says that requests for emergency food assistance is rising faster than they can be met by public and private agencies combined. Surveying 30 cities, they found that requests for food assistance rose an average of 12% this year. In major cities, requests rose 25%. 15% of the requests for emergency food assistance went unmet. The overall level of resources available to emergency food assistance facilities decreased by 4%. Some 53% of the survey cities reported that emergency food assistance facilities are unable to provide an adequate quantity of food. Unemployment and underemployment were cited as the main causes of hunger, as well as the high cost of housing and low benefit levels in public assistance programs. Second Harvest, which is the nation's largest private hunger relief organization serving 25 million people, or 10.4% of the entire U.S. population through its network of 185 food banks, which distribute to food pantries, emergency kitchens, emergency shelters, and other food programs, say that the amount of food being distributed is not enough to meet the present need. Nearly 3,000 of the food programs which they surveyed turned away people for lack of food. Their projected current need was 15% over 1992 poundage. Second Harvest reported also that the working poor, that is people who work full-time at a minimum wage, increasingly need to access food through emergency channels. Food stamp recipients as well must be supplemented through emergency assistance programs because their benefits run out between the second and third week. In closing, I would like to say that I do not think we should trust House Speaker Gingrich and his friends in the conservative revolution with whether we eat or not.
Has been the great equalizer. A core idea of our republic is that every child has the right to the same basic education as every other child. Now, admittedly, this goal of a thorough, universal education has rarely been achieved, especially as it concerns African Americans. But the idea, the dream, sustains. Under the policies put forward by the conservative revolutionaries of today, education will continue to be the great equalizer. The children of the poor and the children of the middle class, black children, white children, brown children, yellow children, will equally become the victims, will equally be assured of an education which condemns most of them to the junk heap. Because under these conservative revolution policies of today's 50 million elementary and secondary school students, only 2 or 3 million really matter. What does Lord Rees-Mogg have to say about American education? Public schools will largely be privatized by the year 2000. With education results steadily deteriorating, public schools are unlikely to survive the trauma of depression in their current costly form. Therefore, it is more likely than most people now imagine that public schools in the United States will more or less disappear in the coming decade. The 21st century will require greater emphasis on the higher skills of the ablest students. In the future, we must concentrate on educating the top 5% on whose success we shall all depend. What exactly does Rees-Mogg mean when he's talking about 5%? He means very explicitly a return to the British imperial system of the 19th century, where 5% of the population got a fairly decent education and learned to play polo and ran the empire and just about everything else. And the remaining population was restricted, prohibited officially by law, from learning classical Greek or higher mathematics or any subject matter that might allow them the freedom to advance their society. Most of the remaining 95% of society back then was trained in subsistence institutions which devoted to what we now call mastery learning. The acquisition of very basic skills which were needed for early entry into the labor market. These schools were, most of them were privately operated, many of them sponsored by corporations to train children for specific skills needed by the sponsoring factory. The American system of universal public education, which grew up after the Civil War, was specifically designed to end this British-style corporate sponsorship of education, a sponsorship which every competent theorist back then knew was guaranteed to throw most of the population onto the junk heap. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if the conservative revolutionaries have their way, then the bad old days of education are coming back. It has been 7 years since George Bush appointed David Cairns, the former head of the Xerox Corporation, to reform American schools and make this declaration of war on public education. Right after 1988, there were some very general steps towards accountability, tentative steps towards vouchers, but parents were very correctly suspicious and most major changes were voted down. However, at the end of the 1980s, as the world financial crisis began to deepen as the high rollers began to move into derivatives to keep the game going, some people started to say, well, look, if we can make money by gambling on the future of interest rates or the future of exchange rates, perhaps we can also make money by gambling on the future of our children's minds. Why? Because we in this country spend $220 billion to educate our elementary and high school students, and another $150 billion for college students, and $50 billion for employer-provided education. And when you add all of it up, the different forms of education, America spends somewhere between $600 and $700 billion per year to educate itself. And up until the 1990s, most of this beautiful pile of loot couldn't be touched by law. By 1992, the arguments for education reform became more desperate. Chester Finn, who was a Bush cabinet member and is the theorist most often quoted by the conservative revolution in education today, had been calling for school vouchers for many years. But by 1992, he started to couch the plan in terms of populism and profit-taking. An empowerment strategy for the middle class and the poor. It costs little. And what's more, if we are not afraid to milk some sacred cows, we can recoup funds. Others were more openly hysterical in their lust to bring that pile of education dollars into the private sector. Privatization offers a potential commercial market opportunity worth a few $100 billion a year. This is the greatest business opportunity since Rockefeller discovered oil. And the Hudson Institute maniac, Lewis Pearlman, who said that, shared a podium with Vice President Al Gore last year at a major conference on education and technology. The conservative revolution forces have since escalated massively. 11 states now authorize charter schools, and more are pending. Vouchers are being discussed in every state in the union, and private corporations run public schools in half a dozen cities and will soon take over schools in a dozen more. This year, when newly elected congressmen got their briefing from the Heritage Foundation, they were instructed to move on every front for the destruction of American public education: decentralization, school choice, charter schools that are outside Board of Education control, vouchers, including private corporate vouchers, takeovers by private corporations, and that great conservative bugaboo, accountability to standards. And these plans represent just a foot in the door. Remember what Rees-Mogg had to say about the trauma of depression. The conservative revolution is banking on a total financial breakdown, which will allow them to force through the total deregulation of education. This was made very clear by the Hudson Institute's Pearlman, who complained that full-scale privatization, and we quote, is being thwarted by a thicket of legal and regulatory barriers and vested interests that can only be cleared by forceful, cunning attack by unapologetically ambitious business leaders. These people want to break the teachers' unions, otherwise known as vested interests, and repeal all state laws which regulate education in order to completely open that $600 billion honeypot to corporate looting. And they're getting away with it, because parents have, unfortunately, finally started to accept the conservative revolution's propaganda about education. Parents have been suckered by 15 years of lies about free trade and are starting to say, well, look, we know the schools are a complete disaster. and no one seems to come up with any ideas as to how to do it better. So maybe we should, in fact, let the competition of the marketplace, the magic of the marketplace, come up with the best solutions. Parents have been suckered by scare stories about falling test scores and the inability of students, American students, to meet standards. The conservative revolution just loves to talk about test scores and standards. They started that discussion in order to convince parents that the quality of education doesn't have anything to do with the conceptual powers of a child's mind, but is really some thing that can be measured by multiple choice tests. We give lots of tests in this country. Students spend lots of time studying and taking tests. They measure nothing. Anybody who knows, who has been in education, knows how to increase standardized test forms. One, you increase the dropout rate. Get rid of the low testers. Two, teach the test. And if you degrade the concept of education to the transmission of a few facts and the mastery of some basic skills that can be measured by multiple choice standardized tests, then you don't need a public school system. Computers teach the test better than teachers. TV teaches the test better than teachers. And the core of all these privatization plans in education is the extensive use of computers and television. That maniac, Perlman, he gives an example which is often quoted. Head Start, which is the major federal program for preschool education. You may disagree with it or not agree with it, whatever. Head Start costs about 10 to 15 bucks to deliver one lesson to one student. Sesame Street, on television, delivers approximately that same preschool lesson for a few pennies. So, you let Kermit the Frog teach kindergarten. The kids stay home. You don't need a teacher. Hell, you don't even need to build a school building. And that's what they're talking about. And that also, by the way, should give you a good indication of why so many private companies immediately offered to buy the Corporation for Public Broadcasting earlier this month. The conservative revolution is relying upon your love and your hopes for your children to make money. There are studies which the conservative revolution theorists use, and I have read, which show that as the economy worsens, the easiest single way to convince parents to accept a reform program in education is to convince them that this program will help their kids get a job, because that's one of the biggest fears that parents have. And these days, you'll notice that everybody is talking about how we have to identify the job skills needed for the 21st century. And we have to specifically train our kids on these lines. Education for the information age, goals 2000, making American students competitive and international standard, you know, all this stuff. All of conservative revolution privatization efforts stand behind this polemic. And this job skills nonsense, which is so prevalent, is the most dangerous misconception that we have and that we have to overcome. Think about it. You can't train a seventh grader for specific job skills which he or she will need 10 years from now. That kind of education only works in a society which is stagnant or dying. In a healthy economy, the pace of technological change is moving too fast to predict the specific skills which will be needed 10 years from now. And this is completely borne out by research on education in the Industrial Revolution. 200 years ago. So you can't educate a child to get a job. You can only educate a child to create new jobs, to create and implement whole new technologies, whole new industries. You can only give a child, every child, the classical humanist education described by Lynn in his keynote earlier in this conference. If you accept the conservative revolution's premise and trade off the development of your children's minds for the vague promise of employment, then you're not training your children for the American ideal of progress. You are, despite your best intentions, training them for stagnation and slavery. It may be something that presents itself as a benevolent slavery, which is offering you a job when you desperately need one. It may be something that presents itself as a high-tech slavery with lots of computers, but it will be slavery nonetheless. Thank you.
We're having a temporary delay due to the impositions of the information age. They're changing the tape. There you go. If you are in the middle class in the United States today, congratulations. You've just been placed on the endangered species list. Under the contract with America, and other even more exotic versions of the conservative revolution being peddled by Phil Gramm, Newt Gingrich, and company, the traditional working class and middle class family is headed towards extinction. Already as the result of 25 years of post-industrial society, which is in fact the heart of the conservative revolution, there's been a dramatic transformation of the conditions of life of middle class and blue-collar working-class America. Even at the height of the Great Depression of the 1930s, those workers who were fortunate enough to keep their jobs were able to buy a home and raise a family on one salary per household. When American GIs came home from World War II, this dream became accessible to a significant portion of Americans through things like the GI Bill. The civil rights struggles of the 1950s and 60s were all about extending that American dream to a segment of the population that had been left behind unjustly. Where does that American dream stand today? Of the 53 million married couple households in the United States today, there are 34 million households in which the wife has to hold down either a full-time or a part-time job in order to pay the bills. We're not talking here about pin money either. The median household income for a married couple family in which the wife is employed is $49,900 a year. For a married family household where the wife is not pulling in a paycheck, the median annual income is $30,300 a year. That's quite a difference, especially when you add in the fact that nearly one out of every two married couple households has children under 18 years of age living at home. The onrush of the post-industrial society has also transformed the workplace for working and middle-class Americans. The number of manufacturing jobs in the United States has steadily declined in absolute terms since the mid-1970s. By 1979, the number of manufacturing jobs had already fallen to 21 million. That figure still represented over 20% of the entire labor force, but the decline was already underway. By 1992, the number had fallen to 18 million, and by the year 2005, that figure is expected to decline to 17.5 million manufacturing jobs. All the while, the size of the total labor force has increased significantly. The decline in manufacturing jobs as a percentage of the total labor force has fallen at a far more dramatic rate. By 1992, for example, manufacturing jobs accounted for just a little bit over 9% of the total employed labor force. At the same time, jobs in the service sector have increased at a phenomenal rate. In 1979, there were already 63 million service jobs in the U.S. In 1992, there were nearly 85 million. By 2000, that figure will pass 109 million out of a total labor force projected at 147.5 million. The average salary for a full-time employee in the service sector is still 30% below that of a full-time worker in the manufacturing sector. Last year, the federal government published a list of the fastest growing job categories and projected the rate of expansion of these jobs up through the year 2005. What are the five fastest growing job categories for the next decade? Home health aides, human service workers, personal and home care aides, computer programmers, and physical therapists. So we are witnessing the simultaneous erosion of the revenue base and the job opportunities for what once was a growing and prospering, skilled working and middle class. I'm not telling you anything, however, that you're not already aware of. To hear Phil Graham, Newt Gingrich, and the Heritage Foundation tell it, their contract with America will provide big tax breaks for the middle class. But read through the 41-page text of the contract, and all you will find is one paragraph buried in the misnomered American Dream Restoration Act, granting a $500 per child tax credit for families with annual incomes under $200,000 a year. That $500 tax break hides a multitude of sins, all of which spell disaster for the middle and working class family. Under the terms of the contract, the federal government will be forced to cut $1.4 trillion in spending by the year 2002. Now check this out. By the year 2005, the total costs will have skyrocketed to $2.6 trillion due to lucrative tax breaks for the wealthiest 10% of the population and some corporations that kick in at the beginning of the 21st century. The contract prohibits cuts in Social Security, defense, and interest on the national debt. So where will those cuts come from? Clearly, the hardest hit will be the poor. But programs like Medicare, student loans, veterans benefits, military and civil service retirement funds, and every form of government-subsidized infrastructure recuperation will be decimated as well. To meet the requirements of the contract and the balanced budget amendment, there will have to be cuts of 30% in every federal program except those three exempted categories beginning next year. On January 10th of this year, the Treasury Department issued a study commissioned by the National Governors Association projecting the level of state tax increases that would be required to offset the lost federal revenue to the states under the terms of the contract with America. The study projects a 17.3% increase in state taxes to just break even and make up for those lost revenues. For some states, the figure was drastically higher. New Yorkers would face a 24% tax hike to just reach break even. Louisiana would have to increase taxes by over 38%. The District of Columbia would have to increase taxes by over 28%. The alternative, of course, would be cuts in services and/or layoffs. Unlike the federal tax structure, many state taxes are regressive, taking the biggest bite out of poor and working class household income. Sales taxes, registration fees, and property taxes can be expected to jump most significantly under the terms of the contract. Now, for the wealthiest 10% of the population, these increased state taxes will be more than offset by the big tax breaks that they will enjoy under the contract. The capital gains tax cut that is at the heart of the conservative revolutionists' game plan is a payoff to commercial real estate speculators and big stock market players, profiteers who have never been willing to reinvest their gains in the real economy. And the new super individual retirement account program simply opens up tax breaks already in effect for families earning under $50,000 a year to people in the upper income brackets. 50% of all of the tax benefits of the contract go to families earning over $100,000 a year. And in the second 5 years of the contract, America's wealthiest households will enjoy a total tax break of $284 billion just in those 5 years. Statistics, as revealing as they sometimes may be, rarely tell a complete, accurate story. This case is no exception. To fully grasp what the conservative revolution means for the future of America's working families, it's necessary to hear in their own words what the leading spokesmen and ideologues have in mind. As bizarre as these ideas may sound, they are dead serious. Had someone told you in 1963 that the United States was about to abandon its commitment to scientific and technological progress, dismantle its industrial and agricultural infrastructure, and move into a post-industrial social order, you would have declared that person certifiably insane and called out those folks with the butterfly nets. But that's exactly what happened over the ensuing three decades. Lord William Rees-Mogg is one of the leading ideologues of the conservative revolution today. He's a member of Britain's House of Lords, the former editor-in-chief of two of the Club of the Isle's leading propaganda organs, the Times of London and the Financial Times, and he currently sits on the board of directors of the British Broadcasting Corporation. Rees-Mogg is also somewhat of a celebrity among American populists through his close association with National Taxpayers Union Chairman James Dale Davidson. Rees-Mogg openly advocates a return to a postmodernist form of feudalism in which 95% of the population is deprived of a basic education and meaningful employment. This new form of feudalism is euphemistically called the information age. Alvin Toffler, the philosophical guru of Newt Gingrich and a propagandist for the post-industrial society, dubs it the third wave. On February 15, 1995, Rees-Mogg published a column in the Times of London endorsing the work of a late 19th century eugenicist named Otto Ammann, who described the social order as a turnip-shaped structure with a small group of geniuses and talented people at the top, a vast middle made up of people of mediocre talent, and a small core of weak people at the bottom. Rees-Mogg warned in his column, quote, "Production by advanced machines under human control in factory conditions has given exceptional opportunities to people of middle abilities and reduced the inequalities of income which different levels of ability produced earlier in history. The information age has created an enormous demand, greater than ever before, for certain relatively high skills, but is replacing electronically the skills of many of those in the middle of the turnip. The factory age rewarded those in the middle of the turnip exceptionally well. The information age will reward people of exceptional intelligence. This will present difficult social problems. Societies that try to redress the balance by taxing their most productive people will lose them. The information age has produced extraordinary geographical mobility. Taxing the rich will be the road to ruin in this new age. Yet, information societies will be harder to govern than the old. There is bound to be popular resentment of the cognitive elite. There is only too likely to be an expansion of a matching but dysfunctional underclass. As the top of the turnip glitters in the sun, the danger is that the middle may become bitter from disappointed expectation while the bottom rots. Michael Vlahos is one of Newt Gingrich's top national security advisors. He is the national security director of the Progress and Freedom Foundation, the private think tank of the Speaker of the House. At a January 10, 1995 conference in Washington, D.C., called Democracy in Virtual America, Vlahos presented his own version of Lord Rees-Mogg's turnip diagram. The speech was titled Bite City, or Life After the Big Change. In Vlahos's world, which is also Gingrich's world, Phil Gramm's world, Rees-Mogg's world, Toffler's world, society is run by a tiny elite, which he dubs the brain lords. Here's how he describes them. The brain lords will not represent a heritable class. They will make it as individuals, and most of them will make it only for a brief time. Burnout will be their limiting factor. Like their prototypes today in entertainment and the media, they will use up their personal capital quickly. The top job niche will emphasize golden parachutes aplenty, with more relaxing work to follow a 40s retirement. Slide. In October 1994, Vanity Fair magazine dubbed these so-called brain lords of today the new establishment. In a lengthy article that featured this photograph of today's brain lords at play at Sun Valley, Idaho family-owned resort of Wall Street bandit Herbert Allen Jr. Among the big shots from the entertainment, computer, and communications industry who showed up for the photo session were Bill Gates of Microsoft, Warren Buffett of Berkshire Hathaway Investments, Michael Eisner of the Walt Disney Company, Rupert Murdoch of the News Corporation, Edgar Bronfman Jr. of Seagram's, John Malone of Telecommunications, Inc., and Gerald Levin of Time Warner. Vlahos calls these people the kinder and gentler robber barons. But they are undeserving of any comparison with the late 19th century inventors and industrialists who fulfilled the Republican vision of our founding fathers and for that reason earned the misnomer and slander of robber barons. In the old days, when we used to be able to call a crook, a meeting like this would have been dubbed the gathering of the National Crime Syndicate, because the majority of people gathered there are actually second or third generation members of organized crime. Beneath the brain lords, Vlahos posits the upper servers, led by a top echelon that he calls the agents. These are the professionals, the doctors and the lawyers, who service the brain lords. Vlahos describes the agents as the new, quote, entrepreneur class. Those who offer tailored information services in Bite City. The rising class of personal information providers and navigators will put real downward social pressure on doctors and lawyers and academics, because agents will get you or take you to the knowledge you need without an expensive appointment with the Almighty. And what about producing the material goods required to feed, clothe, and house the more than 5 billion people currently living on this planet? Vlasos explains, there will still be about 10% of the workforce in production, whether it's growing food or whether it's making things, and they will form a sort of upper tier themselves. Because of the highly specialized skills required to be a new manufacturer, makers, as he calls them, will usually be part owners of the firms. As for the rest of the population, quote, we can suggest that about 25% are doing well, very well. Tomorrow's labor force will include a bottom, an underclass, also about 25%. This, tragically, will be double the population share of those discarded in the bad old industrial era. These are the lost, and in revolutionary times, societies have shown little inclination to find them. 25% at the top, the brain lords and their hand servants, 25% at the bottom, the lost. But what about the middle? Vlahos asks, what will the rest of us, the 50% in the middle, the bedrock of the industrial world's great middle class, the true believers in the American dream, what will we do? His answer is only slightly less blunt than that delivered by Lord Rees-Mogg. The American dream is over. It's gone, with all the so-called good jobs taken by the brain lords and their agents. The middle class in Vlasos's bizarre future world is thrown back in time to a standard of living that he equates with the Midwest mill towns of the 1820s, or the Lower East Side sweatshops and tenements of the 1880s. 12 to 15 hour work days, 6 to 7 day work weeks. Life for the middle will not be much different than the conditions of life of the lost. Now, don't dismiss Rees-Mogg and Vlahos as fools indulging in a lavish fantasy life. They are deadly serious, and although their vision of the future is out of sync with reality, so is the more modest version of this back-to-feudalism scheme, the contract with America. Fight to defeat it now, and success is all but guaranteed. And if you don't believe me, just ask Ollie North. Ignore their words, however, as simply far-out rantings of a lunatic fringe, and they will bring civilization down with them, brick by brick.